Recent advancements in rocket technology and the rise of private companies such as SpaceX and Blue Origin have opened the idea of space travel for the common man. It was not long ago that being an astronaut and leaving our home planet was considered an incredibly rare and distinguished accomplishment. Today, Jeff Bezos and his Blue Origin offer joyrides to the edge of our planet for the right price. New reports state SpaceX has perfected the designs for an artificial gravity starship for making space travel even easier. Let's take a closer look. Imagine that you're inside a vehicle, or another machine, spinning around so fast that the force presses your body against the wall or seat. As you spin faster and faster, the pressure forcing you against the wall increases, and conversely, it decreases as the spin slows down. The weight feels just like the force of gravity that keeps your body grounded to the Earth. If you're like most people, your most dramatic experience with this type of spinning force is probably from an amusement park ride, specifically a classic rotor ride that has produced a great deal of joy since the middle of the 19th century. But a handful of people, including astronauts and military pilots, experience the same phenomenon in a human-rated centrifuge, a machine that spins to produce these high G forces, also called acceleration. They experience this G-force aboard high-performance aircraft during high-speed turns, during launches into space, and when spacecraft rapidly slow as they re-enter Earth's atmosphere. This type of rotation produces gravity, artificial gravity to be precise. It provides weight to your body, weight that your bones and muscles cannot distinguish from weight that Earth or another planet provides on account of its sheer mass. Consequently, for decades, science fiction writers have envisioned rotating spaceships that create artificial gravity for astronauts during the longest phases of space missions. These phases are when they are not extra heavy due to the ship accelerating to build up speed or decelerating in the atmosphere, but weightless due to the craft coasting, negating the effects of gravity. Two examples of such artificial gravity in science fiction are the 2015 film The Martian and the 1968 epic 2001: A Space Odyssey. The Martian features an interplanetary craft, the Hermes, with a large wheel-shaped section that rotates on its journey between Earth and Mars. As the camera zooms in, you notice that up for astronauts inside the Hermes is always toward the center of the wheel, while down, the floor, is the rim. Space Station 5 in 2001, A Space Odyssey, is a spinning station that generates artificial gravity equal to that of the moon's gravity. Apart from mere comfort, there are good reasons why we need artificial gravity on long-distance space missions. For one, in weightlessness, our bodies change in ways that could be harmful when astronauts arrive at their destinations, such as Mars, or return to Earth. Bones lose mineral content, muscles atrophy, fluids shift toward the head and are also excreted from the body, causing changes in the cardiovascular system and lungs, the nervous system is thrown out of whack, and in recent years, space medicine researchers have found what could be permanent eye damage in some astronauts. Add to that research suggesting that gravity may be required for humans to have a normal pregnancy in space, and it almost seems like a no-brainer that any spacecraft carrying humans around the solar system either should rotate or have some part of the ship that does. This is why NASA and SpaceX are researching the possibility of artificial gravity. Since the 1960s, NASA scientists have been considering the prospect of artificial gravity by way of rotation. However, the effort, funding, and overall enthusiasm have waxed and waned through the decades. There was a surge in research in the 1960s when NASA was working on sending a man to the moon. While NASA has not emphasized research on artificial gravity over the past half century, scientists both inside and outside of the space agency are studying a range of situations. Mice spinning in a small centrifuge aboard the International Space Station survived with no problem, and Earthbound humans are learning how to adapt to spinning rooms. There's one at the Ashton Graybeal Spatial Orientation Laboratory at Brandeis University and the DLR Institute of Aerospace Medicine in Cologne, Germany, which is home to the DLR Short Arm Centrifuge Module 1. It's the only one of its kind in the world researching the effects of altered gravity, especially as it pertains to health risks that occur in microgravity. But if the need for artificial gravity is so clear, why bother with research in space or on Earth? Why don't engineers simply get to work designing spinning ships like the Hermes? The answer is that artificial gravity requires a trade-off because all that spinning creates problems. As on the rotor ride, moving your head while you're spinning fast causes nausea. Spitting also impacts the fluid in your inner ear and any other body parts that you move while you're in a rotating environment. And that nausea, disorientation, and movement problems worsen the faster you rotate. But the amount of artificial gravity that can be produced depends on both the RPMs and the size of whatever's rotating. To experience a given amount of gravity, for example, one half of the usual amount that you feel on Earth, the length of the radius of rotation determines how fast you need to spin. Build a wheel-shaped craft with a radius of 738 feet, and you'll produce full Earth gravity rotating at just 1 RPM. That's slow enough that scientists are very sure that nobody would get nauseous or disoriented. Other than the floor being a little bit curved, things aboard such a craft would feel pretty normal. But building and flying such an enormous structure in space would entail numerous engineering challenges. This means that NASA and any other space agencies or organizations likely to send people around the solar system in the future must settle for a lower amount of gravity, a faster rotation, or both. Since there's no laboratory on the moon where the surface gravity is about 16% that of Earth's surface, making it a great place to research the effects of low gravity as opposed to weightlessness, there simply isn't enough data to know how much gravity humans may need for long-term space missions or space colonies. Such data is needed, as is data on how much rotation humans can reasonably tolerate, and that's the rationale for ongoing artificial gravity research. Upon analyzing their own craft, SpaceX has found they face certain technical challenges of their own. For one, the long axis of the Starship is 160 feet from nose to tail and comes with a 30-foot diameter. This design allows for a mere 15-foot radius for acceleration, and a rapid roll on the ship will create extreme stress on the space frame and risk catastrophic failure. What's even worse is that as the crew travels towards the core of the rolling spaceship, the centrifugal force would decrease and cause a substantial difference in artificial gravity. This would cause Coriolis force-induced motion sickness for the astronauts, making them even sicker. Another major issue that comes with having a rotating starship is potential communication breakdown. As the ship will be constantly rotating, orienting antennae precisely could be very challenging and hinder communications. The rotation would force the antennae to continually lose and regain signal as it moves out of its orientation range. A rotating craft could also cause power problems on the journey. The most effective way to generate power in space is with solar panels, and the Starship will be no different. Keeping the panels oriented towards the sun to capture energy as the craft rotates can be very problematic depending on the nature of the rotation and the orientation of the panels. One proposed solution is to tether the crew module to the expended launch stage and rotate it around a common center of gravity. While this option is not viable for the Starship, it does open the way for a different approach that may solve the problem. Having multiple ships on a journey as significant as the one to Mars can prove to be invaluable. If one craft encounters any problems, having another platform and additional resources to work from and fix any issues may end up being a lifesaver. Additionally, having multiple ships also means that rather than using an expanded stage as the counterweight, the Starship may use a second, fully crewed and packaged vessel to tether and act as each other's counterweights to allow for rotation and artificial gravity. The current plan to refuel the Starship once it reaches orbit involves launching a second container unit to rendezvous with the craft and connect with it tail to tail and transfer fuel. This plan means that the Starship has been designed to accommodate an aft mating collar for refueling. It's speculated that this refueling method will be inertial rather than pumped. This means that the fuel and propellant transfer will likely rely on the entire assembly of the craft to thrust gently in a way that causes the fuel to fall into the empty Starship. Since this locking capability already exists, it establishes a possibility of rotation orientation between the two craft. They would both be able to rotate around the mated tails and create a centrifugal force that would be opposite of what it is on Earth. It is also worth mentioning that the structural integrity of the Starship is not expected to be perfectly symmetrical. This means that it will be stronger standing on its tail rather than standing on its head, the same way a building cannot be expected to stand if it were turned over and placed on its roof. This structural issue is likely to be a massive challenge for the engineers of SpaceX. The good news is that the Starship does not need to be at 100% strength when it comes to its symmetry. Since it is designed with a trip to Mars in mind, it only needs to have a portion of the Earth's gravity simulated. This would ensure that the strain on the space frame upside down will be much less than it encounters sitting naturally on Earth. An important factor to consider is how much force we need to create to ensure a smooth experience for the astronauts. The Martian gravity is at 0.4G, and if that much force is generated, the crew will arrive on the red planet completely adjusted and accustomed to the difference in gravity. Scientists estimate that merely having 0.2G of force could also significantly improve the situation for most astronauts, as they face problems mainly related to spatial orientation rather than just strength upon returning to Earth. While the tethering method does solve the gravity problem, the power and communication issues still need to be addressed. Out of the two, the power problem is the easiest to solve. After both crafts rendezvous, the solar panels can be folded out and the conjoined ships can be oriented in a way that the panels face the sun. After that, the axis of rotation can be adjusted so they continue to face the star and produce power for the starship. When it comes to communications, rather than trying to continually recalibrate the antenna or creating a counter-rotating platform, the two ships can be set up to communicate with Earth via a wireless, non-rotating communications platform. This platform will be oriented in a way that allows it to be in constant contact with the planet. Since the platform will be around 100 meters from the rotating starship system, a continuous connection should be within the possibilities of the equipment on board the craft. While these solutions seem effective on paper, testing them practically is another matter. The difficulty of this approach remains significant, as making the starship strong enough for all the necessary adjustments to be made, combined with the stress of the rotation, is no easy task. It'll also be very challenging to design a cabin where the floors can act as ceilings and vice versa. All things considered, if the payoff of these challenges is ensuring the safety and health of the crew, then it will be more than worth it. If you found this video informative, you may also like this one, which talks about NASA's new helical engine that breaks the laws of physics. Would you consider moving to Mars in the future? Please let us know in the comments section below.